A long time ago, in a little town called Sleepy Hollow, there was a school teacher named Ichabod Crane. Now, Ichabod was a tall, skinny man who was quick to use a ruler on naughty scholars. Ichabod didn't live in the town of Sleepy Hollow. To get to his house, he had to ride his skinny old horse through the woods. He had heard stories that there was some kind of a ghost that prowled through the woods. Being a learned man, he put no stock in such tales. One night, Ichabod stayed in town very late at a party. As the evening wore on, after lots of food and lots of cider, the folks started telling ghost stories, and they got around to talking about the ghost in the woods outside of town. The story was that the ghost was a rider on a big horse that actually snorted flames and smoke, and the rider, he was a huge man who had no head. Finally, it got to be very late, and it was time to go home. Now, old Ichabod wasn't exactly scared, but then again, he wasn't too keen on riding through those woods this late at night. Well, he got on his skinny old horse and started off for home. As he rode through the woods, the full moon shone with an eerie light, making all kinds of spooky shadows. An owl hooting in the distance didn't make him feel any better, so he urged his old horse to go a little faster. Was it a dog? Maybe a wolf? Suddenly he caught a glimpse of a strange orange light, and it was coming straight toward him. Now Ichabod was terrified. He tried to make his old horse go faster, but the strange orange light was coming closer and closer. Could it be? Yes, it was a rider on a horse. The horse seemed to breathe smoke and flames, and now the schoolmaster could see better. The horseman had no head. The rider's head was carried before him on the saddle, and he was laughing. The craziest laugh you've ever heard. The headless horseman was coming very close to Ichabod now. He could feel the heat from the horse's fiery breath. They raced through the woods. The goblin was laughing. Ichabod was screaming. It was some wild scene as they raced along the little trail that led to a little bridge near the church. Just as they came to the bridge, the headless horseman suddenly stopped. His horse reared up. And what happened next is the scariest part of the story. The goblin rose in his stirrups and threw his head straight at Ichabod. The next day, Ichabod's old horse was found near his master's gate, but the saddle was missing. Later on, down by the old wooden bridge, they found Ichabod's hat, and close beside it, a shattered pumpkin.
True, I'm nervous, but why do you think I'm mad? My senses are very sharp, and above all, my hearing is extremely acute. Does that make me mad? Listen how calmly I can tell you the whole story. I love the old man. He never wronged me or insulted me, nor did I desire his gold. I think it was his eye. It resembled a vulture, pale blue, covered with a film. It made my blood run cold, so I made up my mind to take his life. Every night, about midnight, I turned the latch of his door and opened it, so gently. When I had an opening large enough, I put in a lantern, all closed, so that no light shone out. Then I put in my head. You would have laughed to see how cunningly I did it. Very, very slowly, so that I could see him as he lay on his bed. Would a madman have been as wise as this? Then I opened the lantern, so that a single ray fell upon the vulture eye. But it was always closed. One night, as I opened the lantern, my thumb slipped on the fastening. The old man sprang up, crying out, "Who's there?" For an hour, I didn't move a muscle. But I didn't hear him lie down. He was sitting up, listening in mortal terror. I opened the lantern so that a single dim ray fell upon the vulture eye. It was wide open. I grew furious as I gazed upon it, all a dull blue with a hideous veil over it. So, you see, what you mistake for madness is just over-acuteness of the senses. Now there came to my ears a low, dull sound, such as a watch makes when wrapped in cotton. I knew that sound, too. It was the beating of the old man's heart. The beating grew louder and louder. The sound might be heard by a neighbor. With a loud yell, I leaped into the room. He shrieked once. Only once, as I dragged him to the floor and threw the heavy bed over him. For many minutes, the heart beat on, but at length, it ceased. The old man was stone dead. Now I took wise precautions to conceal the body. First, I dismembered the corpse, then took three planks from the flooring and deposited the remains. I replaced the board so cleverly that no human eye could detect anything wrong. It was still dark when there came a knocking on the door. I opened it, and three policemen entered. The shriek had been heard by a neighbor who called them to investigate. I smiled and bade them welcome and invited them to search. As the room had been restored to perfect order, I had nothing to fear. In my confidence, I brought chairs and asked them to rest, placing my own seat on the very spot beneath which reposed the victim. For a while, I was perfectly at ease, answering questions cheerily. Before long, though, I felt myself getting pale and wished they would leave. My head ached, and a ringing began in my ears, but still they sat and chatted. As the ringing in my ears grew louder, I talked in a louder voice. Now, a new noise came to my ears, the low, dull sound that a watch makes when wrapped in cotton. I gasped for breath and talked more quickly. The noise increased. I rose and argued about trifles, making wild gestures, but the noise grew even louder. I paced the floor. Will they never leave? I felt I must scream or die. Louder, 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 louder! Then I shrieked. I admit the deed! Tear up the planks! Here! Here! And stop the beating of his hideous old heart!
During a stroll through the countryside, I found myself on the road above a tunnel through which the railroad tracks pass. Down below was a tiny station which was maintained by the signalman who was standing near the great iron bars, which are the means of switching the tracks. I shouted down to him, "Hello down there!" Before he could answer, there was a vibration in the earth which quickly turned into a violent pulsation as a train roared out of the tunnel. As the train disappeared down the tracks, he folded his signal flag and beckoned me to come down. I found my way and joined him at the small building. He looked at me as if he was afraid. When I asked if anything was wrong, he said he thought he might have seen me before. When I asked where, he pointed at the red light at the mouth of the tunnel. I was quite puzzled as I followed him into the little house. Inside, there was a fire, a desk, and a telegraphic instrument. And that was all. I asked what he meant when he pointed to the red light. Instead of answering, he asked a most strange question. What made me call out, "Hello down there"? Why, those exact words. When I asked why those exact words were important, he said he would tell me on our next visit. But please, he said, don't call out. The following night, I returned to the signal station and joined him inside. He told me that he had mistaken me for someone else. When I asked who, he said he didn't know for sure, because the person's left arm is always across his face as he waves violently with his right arm. Then he explained, "One moonlight night, I was sitting here when I heard a voice cry out, 'Hello down there!' I looked out of the door and saw a person standing by the red light, waving his right arm. The voice seemed quite hoarse as it cried, 'Hello down there! Look out! Look out!' I ran to the figure, but just as I got to the place where it was standing, it was gone. I stood there in amazement, listening to the eerie wind blowing through the telegraph wires above me. Within 6 hours, there was news of a horrible crash at the other end of the tunnel. That was a year ago. A few months later, I saw the figure again, and the whole sequence was repeated. Within a few hours, a train came out of the tunnel and stopped at my station. I could hear the terrible cries as the conductor told me that a passenger had just suffered a violent death on board. The figure appeared again last week, but there has been no accident. I fear that this time it will be me." I tried to talk him out of his fear, but was unable to calm him, so I left. I came back the next day to find a train stopped at the little house. I walked up to a group of men and asked what was wrong. The engineer told me that the signalman was killed this morning, cut down by the engine. He had changed the light, but somehow did not jump clear of the oncoming train. The engineer said, "I saw him and blew the whistle. When he didn't react, I waved violently with my right arm as I covered my eyes with my left so that I would not see the disaster about to take place." I had to ask, "What did you actually cry out?" Then he told me his exact words were, "Hello down there! Look out! Look out!"
How old am I? Not nearly as old as I look. Been that way ever since that night when my hair turned white. That night? Well, I was driving home from a dance up near Ridgewater on this little road that leads to the big highway. It's pretty dark and winding for at least 10 miles, bumpy and curving through a forest so thick that the branches keep scraping on the sides of the car like they were trying to keep you from getting away. Suddenly, there's somebody in the road right in front of the car. I jammed on the brakes and stopped just in time. There was this shivering young woman. She had jumped into the middle of the road as if she could stop a car just by holding up her hand. She told me that she'd been in an accident and her car was a wreck. Then she asked me if I'd drive her home. She looked so cold and miserable. I let her in and even threw my white jacket around her because she was wearing a thin silk dress without even a sweater. Well, we started off for her house. And after more turns than you would believe, we pulled up in front of a very tidy little cottage with all of its lights turned on like a Christmas tree. She just sat there looking all worn out, like she had used up every bit of energy she could spare. "Please ring the bell and see if my mother's home," she said. "The bell is on the left near the brass knob." I rang the bell, and the lady who answered looked like an older version of my hitchhiker. Before I even had a chance to speak, she said, "Don't say a word. Just come this way." It all seemed very strange, but I followed her anyway. Up the stairs, down a hall, and into a very pretty room. A girl's room, I could tell. And on the table by the bed, there was a picture of a young girl. It was my hitchhiker. But all around the picture, there was a black border. Then the woman beckoned me to follow her back downstairs. I followed her down the stairs, out the door, and past the car. There was nobody in it. We walked a little further and came to a little private cemetery with a grillwork fence around it. We went in and stopped in front of a grave that looked newer than the others. The woman pointed to the grave and said, "My daughter. She was killed in an automobile accident last summer, and every night someone, some stranger, brings her home again." I was terrified. I turned away and left her there, but not before I noticed something sticking out from under the gravestone. I ran to my car and drove back home as fast as I could. It wasn't until I was in my own house and in my own bedroom that I discovered that my hair was white. Pure white, the same color as my jacket. That's what was sticking out from under that gravestone. Just like it had been there ever since the grave was first dug.
Inside this coffin is the terrifying monster of which you have heard. By day, he is one of the dead. But when night falls, he awakens from his catatonic state, changes into a giant bat, and flies away into the night, seeking the only nourishment on which he can survive. Human blood. Good hunting, my friend, but make sure you are back in your nest before daylight, and don't take any wooden stakes. If you are not afraid to go out on such a dark night as this, I will take you to visit the laboratory of my fiendish neighbor, Dr. Frankenstein. You will find these experiments most interesting. Come, let us go.
Thank you.
are right. That is a werewolf. He is nobody's friend. But you have nothing to fear. The moon is not yet full. Come, we must hurry. It is a stormy night such as this that the mad doctor must have to give life to his evil creation. Chained to the table. Dr. Frankenstein is about to raise the table to the open skylight to receive a tremendous electrical charge from a bolt of lightning. This will bring the monster to life. Watch closely. Look, the monster is breaking his chains. He's getting off the operating table. He's coming toward us. Come, my friend, quickly. I think we had best consider our visit over.
In the steaming jungles of Haiti, the eerie sound of the voodoo drums tell us that this is the night the living dead walk. From the darkness they shuffle, eyes glazed with death, hands clawing for blood. The moans and cries mix with the sounds of the jungle as voodoo claims all in this cult of tropical terror. The zombies walk. Lovers, the moon is a thing of beauty, but to this man it is a deadly curse. When the moon is full, this miserable wretch turns into a hairy, snarling half-man, half-beast. He prowls the night, his fangs thirsty for human blood. He is a werewolf.
Thank you.
In his thirst for knowledge, Dr. Jekyll experimented with his own body by swallowing a diabolical chemical mixture. His hair grew wildly. His features distorted as his mind was claimed by his evil alter ego. And he stalked into the fog-bound streets of London with murder in his heart. He was now the heinous Mr. Hyde.
The mad doctor toils in his fiendish laboratory. The crackling power of his evil instruments blast power into a giant sleeping hulk, which shudders, creaks, and slowly stirs. He bursts his steel bonds and stands. Frankenstein's monster.
In Transylvania, there is a legend that has become a symbol of terror throughout the world. In the dead of night, an evil transformation takes place within the castle of Count Dracula. After he rises from his coffin, he turns into a giant bat
and flies through the night, seeking blood from the throats of his victims. A vampire of death.
A mighty Egyptian pharaoh died in 400 BC and was entombed in a pyramid. Centuries later, a greedy archaeologist plundered the crypt for his own financial gain. He accidentally roused the ancient ruler from his comatose state. Now the mummy drags his bandaged and tormented body through the night, seeking his revenge.
The opera has always given beauty and joy to the world. But once, a famous opera singer became deformed and horribly scarred after he was burned in a fire on stage. He fled the civilized society of the music he loved and hid in the remote darkness of the Paris Opera House. This misshapen being became known as the Phantom of the Opera.
The graveyard at night has driven many a poor soul to
to utter madness. If you value your sanity, do not stray into the evil darkness that surrounds the tombs, crypts, and mausoleums. Here, ghosts wail and moan, skeletons rattle, trying to escape their imprisoning coffins. Grimacing skulls gasp a death rattle. You have entered the Nightmare of Lost Souls.
Working in the lab late one night, when my eyes beheld an eerie sight, for my monster from the slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash!
He did the monster mash!
The monster mash!
It was a graveyard smash!
He did the mash!
It caught on in a flash!
He did the mash!
He did the monster mash!
Wow.
From my laboratory in the castle east,
wow,
to the master bedroom for the vampire's feast,
wow, wow,
the ghouls all came from their humble abode,
wow,
to get a jolt from my electrode.
They did the mash!
They did the monster mash!
The monster mash!
It was a graveyard
they
smash!
They did the mash!
It caught on in a flash!
They did the mash!
They did the monster mash!
Wow.
The zombies were having fun.
In a shoot, wow.
The party had just begun.
In a shoot, wow.
The guests included Wolfman,
in a shoot, wow.
Dracula, and his son.
Wow.
The scene was rocking, all were digging the sounds.
Wow.
Igor on chains, backed by his baying hounds.
Wow.
The puffing bangers were about to arrive.
Wow.
With their vocal group, the Crypt Kick of Fire.
They played the mash.
They played the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard
they
smash.
They played the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
They played the mash.
They played the monster mash.
Wow.
Out from his coffin, Drax's voice did ring.
Wow.
Seems he was troubled by just one
wow
thing.
Wow.
Opened the lid and shook his fist and
wow
said, "Whatever happened to my Transylvanian twist?"
It's now the mash.
It's now the monster mash.
The monster mash.
And it's a graveyard smash.
It's now the mash.
It's caught on in a flash.
It's now the mash.
It's now the monster mash.
Wow.
Now everything is cool. Drax a part of the band.
Wow.
And my monster mash is the hit of the land.
Wow.
For you, the living, this mash was meant to.
Wow.
When you get to my door, tell them Boris sent
and you.
And you can monster mash.
The monster mash.
and do my graveyard
then
smash.
Then you can mash.
You catch on in a flash.
Then you can mash.
Then you can monster mash.
Monster mash.
Catch you as a young boy.